find Exodus, the 20th chapter, in verse 12, if you will, this morning. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 12. We're in the study of the Ten Commandments. We come to a significant shift in the focus of the implications of the commandments. The first four commandments are vertical in their implication. They have to do with loving God with all of our heart. The first, worship God alone. The second, make no graven images to worship. The third, do not take the name of the Lord in vain. And the fourth focuses on the day of worship. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. All of those are about our vertical relationship with God. The remaining six, the focus changes from our relationship with God to our relationship with others. As Jesus said, the most important command is to love God with all your heart. The second one is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, how do you weave those values into a culture? What should we prioritize in order to do that well? Well, that's where the remaining six commandments speak into our life, speak into our culture. They are horizontal. Our vertical relationship with God establishes and enables and directs our horizontal relationship with our fellow man. The six commands that remain provide the building blocks for a healthy, prosperous, God-honoring society. You take away any one of these remaining values, and society begins to crumble. Now remember, in the way of context, that these commands are given to a couple of million Jews who are encamped between Egypt and Canaan, the land that God had promised to Father Abraham. God, through Moses, had led them out of Egypt. They wandered in the wilderness. They're encamped at the foot of Mount Sinai, and they're preparing to enter in and take possession of the land that God had promised to them. But they lack organization. They lack government. And so these commands are establishing culture in many ways, getting the culture of Egypt out of them and reprogramming them to be that city set up on a hill. So the goal was that all of the nations of the earth would come to Israel and hear of the good, gracious God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And these commands, they were to uphold, they were to maintain, they were to defend, and this fifth command is the first with an incentive attached to it. Look at what he says there in verse 12. Honor your father and your mother. Here's the incentive, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. Now, this is not a particular command to a person per se, even though it is. It's rather to a people. If Israel wishes to be established as a great nation, they must weave this value into their society. The fathers must teach their children, and the children their children, subsequent generations, learning to honor the preceding generation. So in other words, this is not saying that if you keep this command that you will have a longer life, more longevity on this earth. But it's saying if we keep this command, our nation will be established, that God has raised up. It's a building block of our society. It's not necessarily saying if we honor father and mother, God will supernaturally come to our defense and aid, although he might. It is saying that mastering this value will go a long way toward establishing any people, a nation, a church, a community, whatever it might be. It's a fundamental aspect of a healthy culture. A family can exist without a nation, but a nation cannot long exist without a family. Over the last 50 years, there has been a seismic shift in our culture in regards to this principle of honoring your parents. Our Western culture has so overemphasized personal autonomy and independence that, in the words of the poet Yeats, the falcon can no longer hear the falconer. Things fall apart, and the center cannot long hold. In the early 20th century, Decisions were made by individuals based upon how would they affect the extended family. Decisions about the reputation of the family. Even decisions about where you would build, land you would purchase, what job you would take. It was made tribally. How would it affect my parents, my brothers, my sisters, aunts, uncles, cousins, grandparents? And it was a tribal decision that was made. Some of you remember, probably in the early service, we have a little bit older demographic in that service. So we have some in that service who were of the World War II generation. Some of you perhaps were of the Vietnam generation or afterward. Many of us in this service were of the 9/11 generation that we're remembering this weekend. But there was a time when where you went to college, the job you took after college, if you did go to college, you made that decision based upon how it affected the larger unit, the family unit. Sometime, and I've struggled to figure out when this occurred, but the best I can tell, the stats began to shift in the 60s. So I'm going to say around the Vietnam era, there was a shift that took place, and that's a long era, I know, but there was a shift that took place in our culture from this tribalism to a very autonomous, individualistic society. I'm not saying per se that Vietnam had anything to do with that change. A guy came up to me in the early service. He said, I can tell you what did it. It was the hippies. They did it. 90% of what's going on was their fault. And so I don't know if he's right or wrong. That was before my time. But nevertheless, something shifted around the 60s. And you see the arts reflect that. You begin to see it in music. You begin to see it in movies and literature and so many different things. There's a significant shift happened in our particular nation in that particular generation. Here's a few things that contributed. Economic growth made it possible for people to live apart from their parents and their grandparents. So where typically the land that I grew up on had been in my family for generations, literally four or five generations. During my parents' lifetime, we moved off of that land and sold that land. It was an economic decision. Their business was growing in a different place, and so we moved to be closer to the business. Population growth with the boomers who came after World War II as that large swatch of society began to explode, it caused people to move further. Social security and welfare made it parents less dependent upon their kids for their well-being. For the first time ever, public education, college education was more accessible, and so you had a generation of people who had a higher level of education than their parents did. The family farm and the mom-and-pop business model gave way to white-collar jobs and big-box stores. Pluralism began to gain traction. So there was a day, some of you who, if you're over 50, I would say maybe over 60, you probably remember when it was a really big deal if, let's say, a Catholic married a Baptist. Do you remember those days? It still can be a big deal in certain families, but in that age, it would devastate communities. I'm reading a book on Joseph Kennedy Sr. right now. For the second time, I've read through this book. It's called The Patriarch. And a lot of material is given to when Kick, the oldest sister, married Lord Harrington, who was an Anglican. Now, not growing up in either one of those movements, I don't know a nickel's difference between a Catholic and an Anglican. That just wasn't my tradition. So to me, they're very similar. But for them, a Bostonian, patriarchal Catholic family, for her to marry a Protestant Anglican, that was a big shift. It made the papers. I mean, people really were concerned about this decision that she was making. But the country was growing more pluralistic, less and less concerned about a particular denomination or tribe, but seeing equal validity in various expressions of not only denominations, but entire religions. So you would see multiple. It used to be that a particular family's religion held it closer together. But now that was beginning to fall apart. Technology, inventions that occurred after Vietnam, almost without fail, and I can't think of an exception to this, the innovations after Vietnam caused more individualistic, autonomous expressions than community expressions. The washing machine, for example, I guess that was after World War II. The washing machine, where washing clothes at one time was a communal effort. Multiple generations would come together at a centralized location and wash clothes. And then with a washing machine, you could, in the privacy of your own home, you could take care of that in an autonomous, solitary, private sort of way. You think about the television. When the television was first invented, one person in a community, maybe your doctor or a lawyer, would have a television. And people from the community would come over, where previously they would sit out as the sun set on their front porch and just enjoy their neighbors. Now they would go together in a home and watch the television. Now, at one time, some of you remember the first television you saw. My dad tells me about the first one he ever saw in their neighborhood. A doctor had it. And so all of the people in the community would go over to his house and just be mesmerized by these moving pictures. And he said the doctor would say from time to time, "Honey, turn that TV off. These people probably want to go home," when he was tired of them. But then, as technology advanced, they made them cheaper and cheaper. So everybody, every home had a television. Then multiple televisions in a particular household. So you had one for the kids, or one for the brother, one for the sister, one for the mom, one for the dad. And autonomy and individuality and separation became more the norm. And today it's in your pocket. You've got devices and you can each be entertained in a very curated way that's just particular to you, rather than everyone coming together. You see shifts in marketing that took place around Vietnam. Prior, marketing would be used to say to the consumer, if you buy this product, it will make you fit in to the culture and the tribe better. If you drive this car, if you drink this soda, if you smoke this cigarette, whatever it might have been, you will fit in better. The idea was people wanted to be a part of a tribe, of a community. After Vietnam, and especially in our own day, they sell products in order to express your own individuality. You can stand out from the crowd if you drive this car, wear these clothes, drink this soda, whatever it might be. It expresses your own unique distinctives. You see shifts in subjectivity. Previously, truth was understood as objective. It was self-evident to a larger group of people. And we could come together and agree, not on everything, but on a lot of things. Today, subjectivity is emphasized. So you have your truth, she has her truth, I have my truth. It's a subjective thing. Sexuality. Previously, sexuality was seen as something that was a part of life. It was a part of a natural appetite. But today, it has become an identity. I remember growing up, again, it was land that my ancestors, when they came over from Ireland and England, they staked land claims and agreed to farm the land in order to own it. And so they came down to northern Alabama, staked land claims. All of the children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren divided up and kept that land. So we had our 3 acres, and it was just down the road from my grandmother, and all of my cousins were right there on that same hillside. And I remember sitting out on the front porch at my mama's house and talking to her with my cousins, and one of the cousins said, "Mama, why did people have so many kids back in the 50s, you know, back in the Bible times? Why did people have so many kids back then?" And Mama kind of laughed and said, "Well, honey, we had to work the land. We had to farm, take care of things. Now, as far back as we've looked, we never owned slaves in our family. We worked our own land, you know, throughout all those years. We didn't have slaves, we had children. And it was not much difference from what I can tell. But that was the way it was. And so they would raise those kids. You had to raise the kids to work the land. You had to work the land to keep the land. And that was the experience of it. So sexuality added to the tribe. Sexuality in its expression added to the family unit. Today, it is an identity. Do you see what a massive shift that is? As a matter of fact, children that once added value to the tribe today are considered a quite costly decision. People are waiting longer and longer to get married. Have you noticed that? And they're waiting longer and longer once they get married to have children. I was riding with Caitlin the other day. I was in my truck. I love my truck. It's my truck. I feel at home in my truck. I feel like I can just close my eyes and it'll take me wherever I want to go. It almost drives itself. But I was realizing, gosh, if I didn't have her, I'd have a really nice truck. She is expensive. And then I've got two that are in college. I'm thinking, man, if I didn't have all three of those kids, we could live anywhere we want to. We could live in a great house. We could have a pool. I mean, you know, we have a retention pond. We could have a pool. We do so many things. And so I'm beginning to be influenced by my cultural norms and see kids as an expensive investment that you've got to weigh out and decide if they're worth it. Abortion began to be more normative because kids can really, they're not adding to your experience, but they're robbing you of your individuality, your personal expression. And perhaps the most undeniable fallout of these cultural shifts pertain to the relationship between parents and children that has become very, very disenfranchised, and it's concerning. From this particular church, I don't see as much of that as I see in some other churches, but it is here, and we've done a lot of counseling around this area. When we approach those times when culture brings families together, funerals, holidays, times when you would think there would be more unity, you see so much counseling during those times because there's so much disunity and disharmony. There's so much difference culturally between adult children and their parents. They're almost like two totally different cultures, as different as two different nationalities. And so you're seeing this strange phenomenon taking place that's making this idea of honoring father and mother as more and more foreign. I don't have empirical data to prove it to you. I wasn't able to dig it up. This has not been studied that I can tell. But in 25 years of doing ministry, over 25 years, working with families, working with individuals, I've never seen so many adult children that are disconnected, disenfranchised from their senior adult parents. Many of you are in the position that I'm finding myself moving into. At that place that we're caring for and thinking about our parents' generation and their needs, but still having responsibility for our children. And more I'm seeing that there's the enemy is getting involved between the first of those relationships. The divergence has been very painful for both parents and children. There is a deep, fundamental need within a child to have a relationship with their parents or adoptive parents, whatever the case may be. And there's a deep fundamental need within the parent to maintain a relationship and have some sort of a legacy with their children. So we come to the text. So both to Israel wandering in a literal desert of Sinai and to Americans wandering in a cultural and relativistic desert of the 21st century, God says, you need to learn to honor your father and mother. and weave this into your experience. I believe this particular command is extremely patriotic. It holds the potential of rebuilding our country to what it once was. Think of it. Jesus was so concerned about this idea of honoring father and mother that as he hung on the cross, drinking of the very cup of the wrath of God, the term excruciating came from that experience of being crucified. Unmentionable, unimaginable agony that Jesus was undergoing. And as he hung there, one of the seven sayings from the cross, he spoke to Mary, his earthly mother, and said, "Behold your son, my disciple John." And he said to John, "Behold your mother, Mary." And he made sure that he handed off responsibility for the honoring and caring for of Mary as he underwent literal hell on earth. It was a big deal. We're told in Malachi, the last chapter of Malachi, we're told that before that great and terrible day of the Lord, the second coming, we're told that one of the things God is going to do is he's going to begin to turn the hearts of the children back to their fathers. And the hearts of the fathers back to their children. There's going to be a revival of family relationship toward the end. I can't think of a better place for it to start than right here. For God to do a work. If you would open your mind and open your heart, what God could do for our families right here at First Baptist today. Well, how do we begin to do that? There's three different levels that this expresses itself a little different. When you're a child, it expresses itself one way. When you're an adult, it expresses itself another way. And when you're in the family of faith, the church, it expresses itself the third way. It's much like they say there's three stages of life. First, you believe in Santa. And then you no longer believe in Santa, and then you look like Santa. Well, there's three stages of honoring your parents. Let's look at each one. Number one, honoring parents in childhood. For those of you who are still under the financial, moral, political, legal oversight of your parents, if you're still under their authority, Ephesians 6:1 says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Obey them." In the Greek, that means what it says. It means obey them. Do what they say. Now, it does say in the Lord. I'm going to have to make a couple of qualifications in this sermon that I don't like to make, but I need to, because it's real. There are some evil people on this planet, and there are some moms and dads who don't deserve to carry that title. If they are evil and if they are hurting you physically, sexually, whatever it may be, psychologically at times, tormenting someone, I do believe there are qualifications for the honor that they can be shown, and you do have to put some safety between you. I understand that. But here he's saying, in the Lord, if this is a family that's honoring the Lord and how they're raising their children, you are to obey, even though you disagree. If you agree, obedience is never possible. You're just doing what you would have otherwise done. Obedience is only necessary when there's disagreement. So when there's a disagreement between you and your dad or you and your mom, the way you honor them is subjecting your will to their will. He explains it in verse 2. He says, "So honor your father and mother. This is the first command with a promise, that it may go well with you and you live long in the land." So he's underscoring and saying, the way you obey the fifth commandment is doing what your parents say. If, as long as you're under their roof, that's how it works. It's honoring to them to do so. Now, there are at least three ways that I would express that. Number one, it's in how you speak to your parents. Now, some of the people who need to hear this most are over in kids ministry right now. Okay, so we're gonna play this back for them, parents. Go, this is Pastor Zach. You need to learn how to speak appropriately to your mom and dad. Now, it's different in North Florida, or as we call it around here, South Georgia. In this area, this is a culture of people who've moved from New York, from California, from all over the globe, you know, that have landed here. My traditions may be different than your traditions. That's fair, and I understand that. There's not a problem there. But speak to your parents the way that they consider honorable. Where I come from, that means yes, sir, no, sir. yes ma'am and no ma'am. If you are an adult and you speak to any one of my three kids, they will, I'm going to gamble on it and say, they will say yes sir, no sir, yes ma'am and no ma'am. You're not going to hear them go, yeah, yeah. Well, I remember when Josh became Pastor Josh. They were very comfortable with him, and they always have loved Josh and as their youth director at the time. But as he became the pastor of Family Ministries, we sat down, and they would say, well, Josh said this. And I said, wait. You don't call him Josh. Number one, he's Mr. Wood at best, but now he's Pastor Josh. You honor him in the way you speak to him. Don't dishonor him that way. And so they learned. And that was our tradition. You have to learn what's expected in your family. I've been around people, I've never understood it, but there's some people when I say yes ma'am, they act offended. I still say yes ma'am to other grown women. That's what I do. But you know, I've got friends that says, don't call me that. You know, okay, I want to honor you in your way. I understand that, but within the context of the home, find out what the norms are and honor those norms in the way you speak to your parents. Don't interrupt them. If two adults are having a conversation, don't go and insert yourself into the conversation. You politely wait your turn. You say, excuse me, and wait till you're recognized. That's just part of showing honor and reverence to an older person, how you speak to them. Secondly, how you serve. Do your part to carry your part of the burden, your part of the load within the context of the home. That may mean keeping your room clean. I have a 13-year-old. I have two kids that are off in college. They've got responsibilities in Gainesville. But I've got one that's a 13-year-old, and as I was studying this, I thought, what can she do at this age to help do the chores around the house? And so I introduced her to our little friend, the push mower. Took her out. It's a self-propelled push mower. I mean, to me, that's heaven on earth, you know? And so I showed her, and we learned how to... Daddy likes a yard mode. I like a diagonal kind of, you know, cut. And so we had to go over that several times to get it the way Daddy wanted it. But I taught her how to mow the yard. I walked right beside her, and I taught her how to do that. That's going to be her contribution, as well as taking care of some of the animals and, you know, keeping her room clean, helping Mom with dishes, different things. And so those are the kind of things that, again, that's just her contribution to do her part. Now, I believe having raised two, and any one of them could go south in a moment's notice, but so far, so good. Happy with those kids. And I have found that it caused them to grow up quicker and take on more responsibility if you trusted them with some things to do around the house and let them know that they could contribute and that they could make a difference. So serve. You speak well, you serve well. Thirdly, submit. Ultimately, you subject your will to the will of the parents. If parenting is done well, parenting is unnecessary. If you use your authority well with your children, there will come a day when they don't need your authority anymore. So you can work yourself out of a job, as it were. And in adolescence, you begin to shift from being that parent-child obedience authority thing to more of a peer. And you're a wise, older peer that can give insight and direction into a life. That brings us to number two, honoring parents as adults. Most of you in this room are in this category. You're not always to obey them. You obey them when you're in their household, but you always honor them. How do you honor them as an adult? Here's some ideas. Letter A, establishing independence. It's wrong to perpetually be a dependent on your parents. Learning how to make an income, learning how to take care of oneself, shows your parents that they did well in raising you. Now, there are occasions where it's necessary and it's healthy and it's safe for an adult child to live with mom and dad. They don't need to be a dependent upon mom and dad. They should contribute to the household. They should do their part. and they should be making future plans accordingly. There was a time when Julie and I first got married. We had sold our home. We had about to start seminary, but we needed to buy a new home, and we were kind of in that process in between. We moved in with my grandmother for a number of months, and I thank God. We learned a lot during that time, and God used that time in our life. And so there are seasons. There were times when my parents have had to move in with me. There are seasons when that happens, and it's good. It's healthy. Many of you are in that category right now. That's okay. I'm not getting on to you about it. I'm just saying, learn, don't be a dependent. They can't write you off on their taxes if you're 30, all right? I mean, eventually, carry your slack. That's all I'm saying. Is that fair? The Pew Research Center has discovered that from 2016 to 2020, the number of kids, adult kids who live, adult, whatever you call them, children, live with their parents, has risen from 15% in 2016 to 52% in 2020. That's rapid. Now, COVID's a big part of that. But you have to consider that during this season, thank God, that's an option. But start looking for ways, because the day's going to come when they're going to be your responsibility. So you need to learn how to take care and provide. Establish independence. Letter B, maintain the relationship. Many of you are independent as families. You have a family of your own. Having spoken to a lot of senior adults and parents, grown adult parents of adult children, please stay in their life. Give them a call. Stop by and see them. Involve them in your activities. Figure out ways. Sometimes mom and I have a standing phone date every Wednesday night. After I leave church, I call my mom. And most of it, so I'm just talking about, you know, she's telling me what went on in her life, and I'm telling her what went on in my life. And she'll ask these questions, and I'll think, why do you care? What difference does it make? Who was in this lunch or whatever? But she does. It makes her feel closer to me if I tell her what's going on in my life. And so I've learned to just, you know, just bear with that and let her see. She can't be here. She's welcome to be. But at this point in life, she's taking care of her mother. So I try to get her as involved in the things of our family as I possibly can at this distance and bring her physically on site as often as we can and go up to see her. Work. It can be a challenge. Thankfully, the culture of my mom and Julie's mom are not that different than ours. We're fairly traditional in our family. But in some families, for better or for worse, some people were raised in a very pagan family, and they've come to Christ. So maintaining that relationship with mom and dad can be quite a challenge. Sometimes it's just experience, college, military service, whatever it was, it's caused your life to be radically different than mom and dad's, and it's a challenge to get along. It's a worthy challenge. Make every effort to lay down your rights, to serve them, to lay down your opinions as much as you can, to maintain a relationship. In doing so, you honor them. Doesn't mean you can't disagree. 1 Timothy 5, 1 and 2 says there's going to be times when you disagree with mom and dad, but you encourage them, you don't rebuke them. If it's a brother or sister level peer relationship, sometimes you can just go and look them in the eye and say, that needs to change, you're wrong. But you don't speak to mom and dad the way you speak to a brother. And if you have been in the habit of doing that, and all the kindness I can muster, let me say I rebuke you in Jesus' name. You need to learn to speak to your mom and your dad in a kind, deferential, honoring way. You say, but Zach, they're mean. They're still your mom and dad. You don't have to speak to them. If they've crossed a line, if they've been evil toward you, it's healthy to put some boundaries there. But short of sin, if they're just different than you, and maybe they get on your nerves a little bit, you still need to be kind to them. You're commanded by Jesus to honor your father and mother. We read in 1 Timothy as well, there is a shift that takes place. It begins in the Trinity. You see that God presents himself as one God in three persons eternally. Father, Son, and Spirit. A family. Then the first image bearers. God made Adam and Eve, and then their children after them, to reflect God and bear His image in the family unit. As God established the church functioned as a family of faith. So we see in 1 Timothy 5, Paul writes to young Timothy, the pastor of the church at Ephesus, and says, when you relate to younger men, guys who are more like your peers, relate to them as you would a brother. When you relate to younger women, relate to them as you would a sister in absolute purity. But when you relate, in the context of the church, now notice how these principles are carrying over from one to the other. As you relate to people in the context of the family of faith, if someone's old enough to be your father, treat him like a father. If they're old enough to be your mother, respect and honor her as a mother. It even goes so far as to say, if their physical family can't take care of them, like if they don't have children or grandchildren to provide for them, if they're a widow indeed and they've lost their spouse, then you as a spiritual family, you come around and make sure that their physical needs are met. Did you know literally the word honor is primarily attached to financial provision? I try to show you something out of these Ten Commandments that you're not familiar with or maybe you haven't seen before. When we think of honor, we tend to think of standing in their presence, you know, taking a hat off, you know, giving them a place in line, whatever it may be. All those things are honoring, but biblically, it's mostly used for taking care of their practical needs. In 1 Corinthians, Paul writes that the pastors who work hard in preaching and teaching, those who lead well, are worthy of double honor, especially those who work hard in preaching and teaching. That doesn't mean two pats on the back as they're going outside. What does it mean? He tells us in the text. He says, that is why it is written, do not muzzle the ox while he is treading. Make sure that he can eat too. Unmuzzle him while he's treading the grain. And he says the worker is worthy of his wages. What does that mean? That means that if you have a ministerial staff in your church, you should financially provide for them. And in doing so, you're showing double honor. You see how that works? It's a financial thing. And you do a fantastic job of that with your staff. In the Gospels, Jesus said, Israel was in the habit of laying aside a portion and saying, when my parents get old, I'm going to save up some money to take care of them practically. And Jesus said what they had done is they started a tradition calling it korban, which meant, yeah, I set it aside for mom and dad, but now it's dedicated to the Lord. I'm going to give that toward the temple. Mom and dad, I'm sorry, but that's dedicated to the Lord. What they would really do is they kept it for themselves. But Jesus said, how do you dedicate it what to the Lord when the Lord said, take care of your mom and dad? Take this financial provision and use it to make sure that your mom and dad have an honoring existence in their later years. It's not the same for everybody. It's not a cookie cutter approach. It may be best for some to move older parents into their home. It may be best for others to get an assisted living situation or to share responsibilities with multiple siblings. It's different for every family, but it is your responsibility that the tables turn. When you were born and you were helpless, they changed your nasty diapers. They fed you. They kept you from getting hurt. And there will be a day when that responsibility for them will be upon you. That's why parents, raise your children in the fear and admonition of the Lord, because one day they will be deciding where you spend your latter years. You need to raise them to be godly people. You need to have them in this youth group. You need to have them in this children's ministry and make sure the Word of God is woven into their heart. And then as you have situations where people have a family who doesn't take that responsibility up, or they don't have a family. The safest place to be as a senior adult ought to be the local New Testament church. Because you know in your latter years, the family of faith is going to come around you and make sure that your needs are met and you're cared for and you're loved as a mother or as a father. Now here, it turns out I can't get any women to admit they're older women. So we have a lot of sisters here in this church. But as you have the opportunity, imagine what it would be like if our families took this serious and we began to think about the preceding generations and the subsequent generations and every decision we made, that we began to honor, truly honor our moms and dads. Even though some are hard to honor, we truly tried to do that. We provided for them. Then imagine that crossed over to our church. And imagine if we had a church where there was no senior adult lady or man who had to worry about a thing in their latter years, because this church was going to take care of them, whatever that means. We were going to see that their needs were met. I believe that if we had that reputation, that if you were an older gentleman or older lady here, these young people are going to defer to you, they're going to honor you, they're going to respect you. I believe that if that was our tradition, we would not be able to build a building big enough to facilitate all the people God would send our way. Or they would just hear about it and say, I want to be a part of that. When you're old, isn't that the kind of place you want to be? You don't want to be in a place where people are going to kind of relegate you over to the side and say, well, we've got to reach the young people. You want to be in a place that will recognize your contribution and honor you and respect you in your latter years. And I believe we could be that kind of church. If we were that kind of church, can you imagine how it would impact this community and other churches? And as that happened, listen, folks, I'm done with this. The biggest threat to our country, it's not Al-Qaeda, it's not ISIS, it's not North Korea, it's not China, it's not the other party from whatever you are. The biggest threat to our country is the failure of the family. It would be very unlikely that we will fall from without, but we are very much in danger of crumbling from within. May that change with us today. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. With heads bowed and eyes closed, you know, if you've been here for any amount of time, you've heard me say that this is a family of faith. That's not just a catchy word or phrase. That's a theological declaration. We are a family. And if God is leading you to be a part of our family, then we will adopt you. We would love to have you. You say, well, I'm not perfect, Pastor. You know what? You've got a family of imperfect people. The only one that's perfect is our elder brother. He's the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth, the Lord Jesus Christ. The rest of us are adopted, and we're imperfect. But if you're here today, and if God is calling you to be a part of our family, then we would be thrilled to receive you. In just a moment, I'm going to pray a short prayer. If you need to join this church, then in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to, when I say amen, you step out and come, take one of these pastors by the hand, and just say, I'd like to join. And we will walk you through that process. It will be painless. We'll walk you through that process. Maybe you're here today and you've never really known a good family. You've never really known God as Father. None of us have had a perfect earthly father, but we have an amazing heavenly father. And you can learn how to be a good dad by being rightly related to your heavenly father. If you need to be saved and be into the universal family of God, then you come today. Whatever the next right thing, for most of us, it just means we need to stop and ask God, how can we better honor our father and mother appropriately? Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you that I have no excuse to know how to be a good son to my father and my mother. Lord Jesus, you demonstrated it so well. Father, by watching Jesus, may I be a better son, and may I raise better children. Lord, I pray that for all of us, you would show us the next step we should take in obedience in order to grow in our sanctification, our discipleship, and to honor you, our ultimate heavenly Father. Speak now, your children are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come if God's drawing you.